Who here is not following what's happening in the market? Because this has a bead on what I'm talking about today. Yeah, the market's lost about 13% of its value. Things that are happening in the market today haven't happened since 2008. Now, would you give all of your money to one person who says, trust me, I'm going to invest it? I mean, would you do that? Right, you probably wouldn't. Would you do that with your career? Would you put yourself in the hands of a recruiter or a headhunter that comes to you and says, I can make all of your dreams come true? I mean, would you do it? And yet that's kind of the analogy. I'm going to be talking about this topic of jobs and skill and pay review forecast. The idea is that if you were to give all of your money to a guy or a woman to invest, they would tell you what the best investments are. You're down to the advice part. Best job, skill, certifications. But wouldn't you also want to say, well, what is your forecast? What are your predictions over the next 3 years? You would want to ask that question. You would want to ask that financial analyst, well, what are your assumptions on how this is going to affect the industries that I'm currently investing in, or the sectors that I'm investing in, and about market growth in those areas versus the overall market? Then you'd want to see some numbers from this person. You know, how has your advice been doing lately? You know, what have you done for your other clients? And then you might take their advice. Today, we're doing the same kind of thing, but we're going to do this about jobs, as if you're putting your, you know, you're thinking about the next 3 to 5 years of your career. Would you go with one person who says, I've got the answer? Or would you want to look at forecast predictions and assumptions? So I'm guessing you probably would. So we're going to get to this fourth bullet point there, but we're going to do it through first looking at what I think are some of the forecasts and predictions that are impacting information and cybersecurity jobs, risk jobs, governance jobs. I would put audit in there too, so that you have a chance to think about this yourself. I'm going to tell you what, as far as how this directly impacts the market for talent. So what I think these numbers mean, and then I'm going to show you a bunch of data, and then I'm going to tell you what I think you ought to do, some hot jobs, hot skills, and there's data behind all of this, which is why I've been able to put some of it in the presentation, but a lot of it I had to put into addendum. So if you want all of our salary and data tables for information security and cybersecurity workers, you can get it that way. I'm just going to show you a couple of salary numbers. I'm going to show you a whole lot of data on performance data. I don't know if you know, did you know companies pay extra outside of salaries for skills and certifications? Did you know that? Well, we've got over 2,000 companies who do that. And we've got data from almost 80,000 of their workers who they pay money outside of salary for certifications and skills. And some of this is in information security and cybersecurity and risk and governance. As an analyst firm, we pay a lot of attention to this because we want to know what's going. We update every 3 months, and so we want to know what in the last 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, what has been climbing and what do we think is going to continue to go up higher. We look at you know, what's going down. Sometimes if something is going down in value, that doesn't mean that we're wanting to have those skills. It simply could mean that supply, so many people have gotten into it that the supply is now catching up to demand. And as that scarcity gap narrows, the price of things go down. So just because something's going down in value, counterintuitively, it could mean that, you know, that's what's happening in security now. The last couple of years, security certifications have been going down in value every quarter. That's because more people are flooding into the field right now from network and, you know, systems administration and engineering. They're coming from all over the place. They want to work in security because it's one of the hottest areas to be right now, and they're all getting certified. It's crazy, and it's driving the price of certifications and some skills down. But the story is that it's a great place to be working. So who am I? Okay. Go down to the bottom first. What is a guy who was a Gartner analyst for a number of years and has been an analyst for almost 30 years? Can you believe that someone actually started in HR? So I started in an area where I thought about pay. I managed pay for a big segment of a company, and then I was living in San Francisco at the time, and I got fired from that job because my company sold off my part of the business. So I just went into tech and never really looked back. But I found myself to the analyst business, and I never liked Gartner analysts. They used to always be after me because I had all this information that was happening in the Valley. But I never had much respect for them because they didn't do real research. They formed a lot of their opinions on talking to people, and maybe it wasn't a lot of companies, and they would form an opinion and go out and blast it to the world. And you would make decisions based on that. But when it comes to people in particular, you need a much deeper level of research, traditional research, and those companies don't do this. They're not really research organizations, they're analyst firms. So when I started my company in 1997, I just started doing really deep research, and right now we collect all of our information, our data, and all of our forecasts and assumptions from 5,500 companies in 15 countries, including the US and Canada. And then I spent a bunch of time in Silicon Valley doing all kinds of things, but I spent a lot of time with exceptional growth companies, companies that were gonna go from zero to 4 billion in revenues, which is amazing growth. Well, what happens to those companies? What's the downside of a rapid growth company? Anyone work for one here? What are the downside of these fast growing companies? Anybody? It's burnout. People in those organizations burn out. They're like hamsters. They're just running so fast. Eventually, all kinds of awful things happen. I always focused on, let's look at the people side of these rapid growth companies. So I think it helped inform me a lot, you know, when I started getting into looking at this. And so you can't look at technology without looking at business and HR and also the tech side. So we formed a company, and we got big shots from all these companies, again, to look at tech labor and the tech workforce and the evolve and how it was reacting to these disruptive technologies, these incredibly rapid growth opportunities for companies to monetize, increase their revenues, increase their profitability through technology. But they had to field a bunch of people that could do this work and not burn out, because I knew exactly what burnout look like in these companies, but how to do that over a period of years. And always have the talent that you need, which generally means you have to develop it internally, because a lot of rapid growth technologies, there just aren't people with 4 to 6 years of experience in blockchain or in AI and things like that. So you end up having to develop a lot of your people internally. And this is what's happening in information and cybersecurity right now. You need to sort of develop people internally. So I think I already talked about this. Yeah, we take data from a lot of companies. They're research partners of ours. They are the gods in our business because they give us amazingly detailed, confidential information. And for that, we will give them NDAs. We will just never tell anybody that we're talking to them. You know, if there's a trust factor, people will give you a lot of information. So I'm going to be sharing with you a lot of that information today. So we're primarily North America. We don't crowdsource anything. You know, there's a lot of compensation data out there. You all know you can go to any of these sites to get it, but it's crowdsourced data. Ours is not crowdsourced, because in a research organization, you have to think about a validation of data. You have to think about reliability of data. It has to be good. So that's our business. I think I may have mentioned this earlier, but let me mention it again. I think job security and growth in the cybersecurity, risk, governance, audit, information security areas, the best it's been in 20 years. And I've had 20 years that I've really been looking at this as an analyst and as a researcher, but here's the problem. You're on your own. Most employers can barely provide a roadmap for anybody but software engineers and developers, because they prize these people. They focus on the developers, they focus on the engineers, because they are customer-facing. A lot of you guys, not all of you, but many of you are not customer-facing. You're not necessarily making money for the organization. The people that are get a certain amount of career advice. Security people tend not to in most companies, except in professional services firms, where the assets walk out the door every night. You know, they don't have a lot of they don't have manufacturing their people, and so they develop their people. I look at it like a tsunami. What do we know about a tsunami? This is from an article in the New York Times in May. First sentence, At first warning, you should get to higher ground. That's it. That's how you survive a tsunami. If you're seeing it and you're on the ground, you're probably dead. If you know it's coming, you can get to high ground. So what I do is I look at the tech industry and business right now as all these buildings that are about to be hit by the tsunami. They're all the various functional areas of the business. And of course, product development. Let's put a particular focus on that. New products, disruptive technologies. It's where all your AI stuff is right now, for instance, in blockchain. And then you have all the groups, the technology groups, essentially, and it's not a complete list, but that support all those buildings that are about to get pounded by this wave. The wave, to me, is disruptive tech and influences. There are all these things that you're trying to monetize, your board desperately wants to get into, but they're risky. They're risky for a lot of reasons. You may choose the wrong partners, but do you have the people? Can you field a team of people to build this stuff? And after they do a good job, can you keep them? Because somebody else wants those people, because they have demonstrated that they know how to build something. So can you keep those people? And I think that is also real and imagined security threats. But what about the unimagined security threats that we sit in this room that we'll be talking about at RSA 5 years from now, but we didn't talk about them in 2020? If you've been following RSA, I mean, I think I started at RSA by doing a keynote 14 years ago. Think of the things that we know now that we didn't know then, and we're supposed to be experts. So I think there are a lot of unimagined security threats that we're dealing with here, too. That's a workforce issue. That's a people issue, too. But I think at the end of the day, getting to high ground is the only business imperative. It doesn't matter what your plans are, how much money you throw at things. If that wave rolls in and you didn't see it coming, you'll be merged. You'll be acquired. You'll be dead. That company won't be worth as much as the one that got to high ground and protected itself. The first tsunamis have already hit. That's when we have all these persistent tech skills gaps, this inability to forecast beyond even 6 months, let alone two to three years. The idea of finding and hiring these multidimensional workers with endless variations of business, soft, technical skills. You've probably seen these job descriptions. Nobody can fill these out on the internet. We laugh at them. We have a hall of fame of job descriptions that are posted on the internet by companies that nobody would, we don't know anyone that could match any of these, you know, these experience factors and things. You know, they're just laughable, but HR departments just don't understand that. Some of you don't understand probably how to describe some of these jobs. These people do not exist. Retention issues are more severe, and the marketplace is incredibly volatile. Here's an example of what I'm talking about. So we track the market values of skills and certifications, individual ones. So we're just posting on this. The blue line are certifications. The green line are non-certified skills. So we've got, I think, about 500 certifications, tech certifications. And the green line, we have about almost 600 non-certified. And the red in the middle is the average of all. If there was no volatility, everything would be down at zero. All those lines would be down at 0 or 5%. But do you know, every 3 months in the certifications and skills that we track, again, market pay, cash, pay premiums companies are paying, about 225 to 250 are changing in value every 90 days. That's crazy. But that's what market volatility is right now for people and for pay. It's really, really volatile. It's changing on the order of 25% every 90 days. And as you can see in the green line, it's been as high as 45% over just 45 days. And that was back in 2007. So this is a chart, if you can't see from the back, goes from 2007 to the end of 2019. So there's volatility in the marketplace for talent. So let's talk about these disruptors, this tidal wave, if you will. This is just a short list. I put in red what some of the economic impact is on some of these and why we're talking about them. They're important to the business. They're being monetized. They're a source of revenue, source of profitability. Just, you know, take a quick look at these, because we're only going to be able to talk about these today in 50 minutes. I want to focus a little bit on AI-driven development, machine learning. We'll do a little deep learning, AI security. We're going to talk about Internet of Everything. used to be called Internet of Things, now it's Internet of Everything. We're talking about what were data streams turning into data lakes, now we're data oceans, and now we're almost into data space right now, just the sheer amount of data. In the last 2 years, 90% of all information from the internet came in the last 2 years. The internet goes back to, 1994, 1995. 90% of everything collecting, data from the internet has been the last 24 months. That is an amazing number. What's it going to be 5 years from now? It's going to be 5, 6, 7, maybe 10 times that. This is a good thing, but the risks are amazing. This is what's changing our life right now. This is what your companies are going to be asking you guys to secure. This is a crazy list if you think of the fact that we can barely secure what we have right now. And then we're heading into this tidal wave. So now let's try to get to high ground. Okay, I'm going to look at some broad and some specific trends in some of these three areas. So what I think is stimulating demand for talent is just this fact that digital transformation is not a buzzword anymore. It's pure competitively driven. It's being measured right now. Companies want measurable results and they want profitability. They're serious about it. For many years it was a buzzword, but it's not now. Internet of Everything, AI deep learning, hottest development targets over the next 2 years. Which is saying something. It's a long list, so I'm saying these two are going to be huge. And it's going to be driven by investments, we think, in these four industries, healthcare, automotive, manufacturing, and retail. So those of you in this room in those industries, stand up because, you're going to be pounded on for securing this stuff. This idea of ad hoc data analytics, we've been doing that for a long time. Now we're operationalizing production quality big data pipelines. There's a reason why chief data officers are showing up all of a sudden. How many of you have a chief data officer in your company? Yeah. Well, at RSA 5 years from now, every hand will go up because companies are acknowledging they need somebody at that level to be able to manage all this data, this just crazy data space, as I call it, or data oceans. This is what's coming at you. So I think that's had something to do with why these, production quality, operationally, huge, well done, huge, secure networks and pipelines are coming at us. Okay. Let's go to big data. Just a couple of trends. Again, in 50 minutes, I can give you some of these things. 25 billion connected things by 2020. You've probably heard that number elsewhere at this conference because it's a Gartner number. The one you may not know is the trillion by 5 years from now. That's a lot. And that's probably a conservative estimate. Rise of public cloud usage, ready to run big data platforms, automated machine learning, analytical databases. That is full employment for cloud, the cloud workforce. We started covering cloud jobs in 2007. We published all of the job descriptions and all the compensation data for cloud jobs. I think we had 13 or 14 of them, the architects, the analysts, the administrators, the developers back in 2007. Well, this is now a huge new wave of cloud full-time people, including cloud security people. So there's an opportunity there right now. At that alone, those of you working in cloud security, big area, lots of demand. Real-time streaming analytics, rise of endpoint security, Linux containers, Kubernetes, all that stuff. You know this. Let's talk about IoT for a second. What's stimulating talent demand? Well, look at those growth numbers in the IoT market. Look at those growth numbers. That's crazy. That's real money. Who's going after that? A lot of companies are going after that money. Gartner predicts by this year, 25% of identified cyber attacks will involve Internet of Things, Internet of Everything. We think that the biggest revenue impact, the companies that are really going after this stuff, again, if you're in any of these industries, vehicle, public health, transportation, health and fitness, manufacturing, operations, retail, pressure's going to be on you. It's in the next 3 years. Okay. So we're now starting to peel away the onion, starting to get a little deeper into what I think are the best bets for your jobs and skills going forward. We're going to develop this as we go along, and then at the end, I'll sort of wrap it up and kind of summarize it for you. And artificial intelligence, machine learning, will go even more mainstream and deeper. As if it isn't mainstream right now. When large companies, 80% of them are doing something in machine learning. A lot aren't. So they'll be going deeper. More companies will be getting into it. Deep learning networks, as they, you know, it's almost a no-brainer. Okay. And I can, if I had time, I'd go into all the technologies behind this and skill areas. I wish I did. I think the addendum that you'll get, I'll put some of the slides in. We'll take each of these and sort of drill down to the skill areas. Because some of these companies are, again, willing to pay extra money for TensorFlow Python people. You should know that. But I just can't, you know, don't have time today to be able to get all this on one slide. Cybersecurity, what's stimulating talent demand? Well, the role of cyber to me is becoming even larger in our personal and professional lives. Almost like seatbelts locking the door at night. The whole new level of, my wife is a journalist. She's a writer. She barely can operate a cell phone. And she understands this. She is sensitive to cyber threats. A complete Luddite, really. And that's, I say that in a loving way. She's aware of this stuff. It's crazy. I think smarter, more sophisticated systems will be routine. I think more bot-driven cyber attacks, that's important. Because as you've heard over and over again at this conference, you have to fight machines with machines. That's what's coming at you, sophisticated attacks that are just were unthinkable 5 years ago. I think natural language capabilities of AI will play a bigger role, scanning larger portions of data across the web, huge amounts of data across the web. I think AI will help reduce risk, but here's the important thing why I put it in red. It's not going to solve the cybersecurity shortage, because I'm here to try to help you to understand that shortage will always exist. And the reason why is because of disruptive tech. We're so far behind from a labor point of view that we're always going to be behind in this too. Now, AI will help remove humans from some jobs, but there will be other jobs. This is why automation, you know, the media has it wrong. Automation creates new jobs. It replaces old jobs. And we focus more on people that are out of jobs that don't have the skill, the ability to reskill themselves. That's how the media focuses. In my job, I focus on all the jobs it's creating that didn't exist. And again, if we had more time, I'd love to take you through those slides. All these new jobs that are coming in the next 3 to 5 years that some of us in this room will have an opportunity to qualify for, even in the analyst community too. But I just think that there will always be this issue. Don't be persuaded that it's different. There will always be a skill shortage in these areas, no matter how many people we throw at it. For those of you who operate in the government here, in particular, nation-sponsored organizations will continue to develop cyber tech technologies. We work with a lot of beltway companies who are the primary staffing augmentation firms for the NSA and DOD, and so we know what their opportunities are here, and they're in stuff like this. You know, it's pretty serious stuff. If you're you do any work in that area, what's coming at the governments and nation states in terms of going after our water supplies, power grids, traffic control, and stuff like that. So I just want to put that in the presentation, though, for those of you who might work in those industries or support those, support the government or work in the government itself. And not just in the U.S., how many people are not from the United States visiting here from that? Yeah. So this is a presentation that I do all over the world. Of course, it's different depending on the audience, but these are international. It's really international in focus, although I will show you North American data. But it's really, these are all internationally focused drivers. You probably heard this here, IAM, huge area, huge compound annual growth. The places that I would like to focus on for you in terms of skilling and in terms of where the needs are in adaptive authentication, machine learning skills, biometric authentication skills. Companies are paying for this stuff. They want people in these areas. Throw your work in that direction. You know, that's what they're looking for. That's just in IAM, those three things. There's a longer list. Or a lot of companies are just doing homegrown. They're doing it with cybersecurity teams. They're doing what they can. Trend stimulating talent demand again. Rising demand for workers' experience with supervised algorithms, unsupervised learning. AI machine learning will play an even larger role in protecting the entire, you know, customer experience. I've heard that from a number of speeches today. I know that that's a topic here. They're looking for machine learning experts. They're looking for security people with AI. They're looking for this. They can't get enough of these people. So, you know, that's one of the things that you're already hearing from me here. AI is the place to be in a lot of areas in tech, but in security in particular right now. Okay, so now we're going to move from forecast, and I hope, you know, I went kind of broad in that. I couldn't get really deep, but I think you get the gist of what the forecast is. How does this affect our assumptions on the tech talent, labor force demand, what's driving it, and market growth? Let me just start by cybersecurity risk market size, $3 trillion in 2015, $6 trillion in 2021. The world will spend $1 trillion cumulatively on cybersecurity products and services. Worldwide cybersecurity market forecasted to reach almost $450 billion by 2023, driven by aerospace, defense, intelligence verticals right now. Hot areas for some of you, let's look at the hot areas. Again, I want to continue to drill down piece by piece in this presentation. This is an interesting number I didn't know until about a week ago. There is an organization that tracks mergers and acquisitions. In 2019, they totaled almost $28 billion of aggregated disclosed value, the largest investments. You would think data security and IAM, but can you imagine that risk and compliance was one of the areas that people are investing in? That's amazing that risk and compliance is a hot area to be in right now for all of you, for a lot of reasons. You know, GDPR, what's happening in California, the fact that we are now seeing more and more chief privacy officers in companies, it's a big issue. There is more compliance coming, but that is an area that people with money are investing in. They think there's money to be made in risk and compliance, which is pretty cool. Demand for cybersecurity workforce, you've probably seen this number before. We start getting at the gap in this number. We start looking at, well, I think this was presented at this, there was a session on this workforce study, gap of 1.8 billion jobs by 2021. And cybersecurity professionals, you know, the growth rate, 12 times faster than the total labor market. So that should, all this should be obvious to you. I almost took this slide out because I think we all know these numbers by now. Demand assumptions, more employers will internally develop cybersecurity experts because they can't find them. So that's what we're telling people. That's what we're actually seeing. So I'm telling you that because in the almost 5,500 companies that we're tracking, that's what we're seeing. They're doing it internally. They can't wait. They're hiring some externally, but they're mainly developing internally. So the questions we have are, what are the feeder groups, you know, for these jobs? You know, where do we look in the organization? And I will answer that question. And it's not the answer that you're probably thinking, because they're filling these groups with non-technical people. They don't want people that come out of engineering programs and engineering degrees. They want a very different group, very interesting group of people working on cyber problems in particular. We'll get to that. Human analysts will be even more overwhelmed than they are right now. Greater reliance on smart tools. I think we've sort of gotten to that already in terms of next generation firewalls and machine learning technology built into them. But they're looking for people to run this. Collaboration apps will become even more popular. Increasing malicious content opportunities and hackers. This is an interesting study because this came out of KPMG. So they asked, which functions do you feel suffer from a skill shortage? The reason why I like this study, because it's not one of ours, so for me to actually put up somebody else's numbers for this, I just liked it because it's 4,000 people, 84 countries, that's a great study. So the number one, number two, number three, there was a tie for number two, are big data analytics skills, cybersecurity skills, and artificial intelligence skills. But what gets me is this. If you look at how this has progressed, from 2015 to 2018, it's security, resilience, and big data analytics that had that progressively grew, had the biggest jumps in the last couple of years. So that's where the heat is right now. So more, again, more, in this case, a global confirmation that that everything I'm saying is true. It's not just coming from our data, but from others. Capgemini did an interesting study on AI. The question was, well, is AI going to rescue us from this conundrum that we're in? And they had some key findings about the overwhelm in cybersecurity analysts, and that senior executives, almost 70% say they're unable to respond to cyber attacks without AI. All of that is good. You can see from the other bullet points, you know, it lowers costs, provides higher accuracy in detecting. So the what in this report are, they're mainly doing it, it's the green line. You want to look at the green slices here. That's where most of the AI is being directed towards. It's detection, prediction. Very little in response, only 18% said it's high utilization. Probably at this conference in 3 years, you'll see that green number of 18 being more like 51, so you'll see a real growth. But right now, it happens to be in detection, prediction, not so much in response. Response is still a human activity, I think, in this case. We'll find some way to automate it, of course. As far as the where is mainly network security and data security in this study. As to you know, how do you use AI in cybersecurity in those areas? And the who is looks like it's being done a little more saturated in banking, consumer products, and telecom. As far as use cases, we can't go into much detail in here, but clearly everything up in the upper right-hand corner are low complexity and high benefits, so the use cases are in fraud detection, malware detection, you know, scoring risk and intrusion detection and stuff, but then you'll see some of those areas over to the left, high benefit, you'll see some of those coming in the next couple of years of how AI is going to be used. Again, just an interesting talking slide. Can't get much into it, but take a look at the slide a little more when you get a copy of the presentation. Now we're going to move into numbers, which is the fun part of this. Any questions at this point? Anything not clear? Anything you want to tell me? If not, we'll just go right into some of the numbers. Okay, so we're going to look at North American data. Let me take you through the industries and the cities that we cover. So it's about 3,500 employers here, 40 industries. Data about pay for about 320,000 tech professionals. These are the industries that we're in. It's about 38, 39 industries. I think you'll find yours in here somewhere. These are the cities. Let me just keep that up for a little bit. So we're looking at 18 cities in Canada in this particular segment of our data and 65 in the US. So we think we have it pretty well covered. So in our salary data, we have a lot of different ways that we package this data, but I wanted to point out the list to the left. These are all job families, so we're now tracking pay in about, pretty much you can dissect the tech workforce into about 37, 38 different buckets, if you will, you know, families. So that's how we look at it. And then we have this whole other area here, which I've talked about, which are skills and certifications. And I want to talk about that first. So I think we talked about this. I think, yeah, about almost 80,000 tech professionals. We update this data every 90 days. So anybody who does contact us to get this presentation or the addendum, you're going to get probably the most popular thing that we do. It's an MI report that is so amazing that we just give it away. We sold it for years, but we just give it away to people. We think you need analysts. We believe in education. We believe that you should understand what's going on in the marketplace. You should get good, concise analysis you can't get for free on the internet. We give this away. That's the difference between us probably and consulting firms, is that we like to give away a lot of stuff and educate and raise, you know, the ocean on what's happening. in the next 2, 3, 4, 5 years. So that's a report that we'll give you. And again, we sort of have buckets, just like in salaries. We have buckets, if you will, segments in certifications and non-certified areas. You'll see some similarity between the two. There just are not, you're aware, there are not certifications in a lot of areas of technology. There just isn't. There aren't any certifications. So that's why the certification market is very specific to security and to networks and systems. It's very vendor-driven. Not everything, or vendor-independent. The non-certified area is much more at play. There's so much more available to focus on and to pay in the area, and that's why those, that green number, this is like a 20-year chart of the average pay, again, expressed as the equivalent percent of base pay for a skill or certification. That green line is non-certified, that blue line is certified. So you can see that non-certified skills on average are paying, you know, close to, on average, close to an additional 9, maybe 9.5% of base when people are given skills premiums. Security, or excuse me, certifications are down. Pretty soon they'll be around 7%. There's a big wide gap. Anybody want to tell me why certifications have been losing value over the last couple of years? It's an interesting, perhaps it's not interesting to you, but certifications can be manipulated by money. They're driven by vendors. I haven't met one vendor that didn't have their certification group and their sales and marketing group. I mean, it's there to support their products. These guys up here in the green line, those are market forces. If somebody's willing to pay for a non-certified skill, there's a reason for it. They figured it out. There's no vendor telling them or selling them a product and saying, we're going to support it by certifying all your people in this product. I mean, that is very pure what's happening on that green line. But you can see it's going up. So the incidence of companies paying outside of base for a skill is how they're dealing with all this multidimensionality. You know, if you work in a compensation group, you know, you just have these ranges. You pay people within ranges. You put them in grades. And you can only go as high as what the range is in their grade. But the fact of the matter is that that's not very agile. That doesn't give you much of a ability to meet a market number, a local market compensation number that's being driven by, as I pointed out before, a hot skill. That hot skill could easily drive the value of that skill up 30 to 40% over 6 months. How do you deal with that if you're just looking at salary? You can't. You have to put it in more of a total compensation point of view. And it's also the way that you retain people, because there are all kinds of companies that will come in and say to one of your people, you can do the exact same thing you're doing here. We'll pay you 15% more. What they don't tell you is that they're not going to give you anything more than that. They're going to give you salary. They're not going to give you much bonus participation. So they prey upon people that pay low or average salaries but have a lot of participation, sometimes performance-related, sometimes, you know, hot skill-related beyond that. But at the end of the day, both companies are pretty much paying that person the same amount. It's just a marketing trick that recruiters use. And skills compensation is often used as a way to get around that trick, again, that recruiters use. So let me roll through this really fast. So I just wanted you to look at what's happening in the last, we went back to, I guess, 2004. So that's the last, like, 15 years of pay for certifications. You'll notice that the highest paid ones are information and cybersecurity certifications and architecture project management process. Interesting. But even those have been going down in value lately. But information security is right up there at the top. I also have this arrow down here at database, because I think all that stuff happening in the Internet of Things and Internet of Everything and all that stuff happening in data management and data security and data privacy and all that stuff is driving a certain amount of demand for security people. So I would watch those two lines. And isn't it interesting that they're both in the top three highest paid areas for certifications? That's important. That's a good thing for everybody in this room. So if you like looking at tables instead of graphs, that's sort of the table. And I just put a yellow line through information security so you can see that how they have been losing value. Again, not a bad thing. In this case, a sign that, you know, people are getting into the field. Let's look at security certifications, the highest paid. I'll just keep this up for a a little while so you can see if your certification is on this list. So what you're looking at here is the 10th, 50th, and 90th percentile. So I like to look at median a lot. That's what people in the middle are earning. But you can see that certifications on average, this comes from a lot of data, you know, these are the ones making on an average between an extra 13 to 16% of base pay. And these are solid numbers. This is a survey that we've been doing since 1999 and updating it every 90 days. So it is pretty much the only one that anyone uses that we know around the world. It's the only one that exists to really look at skills premiums and how much to actually pay people when you choose to use this form of compensation. Moving on to the next one, I thought I'd show you the ones that have, in the last 6 to 12 months, have been gaining the most value. Any comments on these? And some of these values are incredibly high. 12 months, 70% increase in certified forensic analysts from SANS. SANS loves that they're at the top of this list, by the way. So this is kind of what's happening on the upside. Now, this could all change 12 months from now, but in the last 12 months, and we focused a little more on 12 months, this is what's going up in value. In the interest of time, I'm going to move on to the next one. This is what's going down in value. Again, don't assume that necessarily the world is devaluing some of these. We get numbers. We ask certifiers, how many people did you add this year, and if they've grown by 15 to 20%, some of these numbers, we know that if they're going down, it's just because the gap between supply and demand is narrowing and it's driving the price of that skill down in the marketplace because they've been successful in certifying more and more people. Anything jump out at you all? Oh, I put the one in yellow because that is the highest paid in the group, highest paid in losing value. It's a cyber forensic professional. Figure that out. Well, a lot of people decided to get that. So maybe the world hasn't discovered that from a demand point of view. Maybe demand will go up and supply will go up. But right now, that is probably a victim of its own success, more or less, I'd say. Okay, certifications. Hang on a second. I thought I'd put some auditing. I mixed all the auditing-related certifications and skills in there, created a list for you. Again, not something we want to stare at a conference presentation, but something you'll want to look at later. It's in the presentation if it's important to you, if you're hiring, particularly if you're hiring people. Not if you necessarily have that skill or certification yourself, but if you're hiring, it's a conversation you'd want to have with your HR department. You know, why can't we consider for some people? Because we can't afford to lose these people. If it's a matter of they're at the top of their salary range and they don't qualify for a promotion, you know, are we going to lose them over money? Well, hell, that's one of the only things we can really control, frankly, when it comes to recruiting and hiring. It's one of the only things you have to control. So you got to get that right. Let's look at non-certified skills. I want to point out to you here that are very similar to certifications, in this case, management methodology process skills are the highest paid. They tend to be higher paid because they're more advanced. I mean, some of them require, you know, prerequisites just to sit down and take an exam. You know, so they're harder to get. So there are fewer people in those and they earn more money. But look at data and database, right up there. Fastest growth of all of these. Again, a feeder number for us as analysts to what's happening in the information and cybersecurity community. The more data needs protection, kind of like that. It's a little more than that, but that's just the idea that I'd like to share with you today as to the relationship between data management, and data privacy, and information security. Again, if you want to look at a tabular view, right there, you see a lot of green numbers, a lot more than you saw in the certification group. And non-certified security-related pay premiums. Again, I put these in alphabetical order, just so you could move your eye down them. Feel free to take a picture if you'd like and have a conversation over coffee. Come and see me if you'd like. Again, really, really good numbers from a really good source. Go to the bank with these things. you can make arguments for even your pay or your people's pay and use this data, because it really is, it's real. It's, again, not crowdsourced. For auditing skills, there are a whole bunch of security auditing skills. I want to focus a little more on the ones in red. I've talked about them earlier. These are some of the tools as well that we see right now in the heat, in our heat index. And then let me show you currently, since I put all the other security numbers, you know, the salary numbers in the addendum, but what you're looking at here, the top line is the national average across 65 cities. Then I have the national average highest city, lowest city, so you're looking at probably, highest cities are usually in the Bay Area. Not always, but, you know, San Jose, San Francisco, maybe New York is in there sometimes. Lowest cities, again, not a pejorative statement, but they tend to be maybe Oklahoma City or, you know, Louisville or some of the South Carolina cities, you know, cost of living being lower, that's the only point I'm trying to make. And then the actual cash bonus and actual total direct cash for these jobs. So that's how to read these charts. This happens to be cybersecurity senior and mid-level security specialists. So it's amazing on a national level that a cybersecurity specialist is averaging almost $100,000. That may seem like a small number or a large number, but you know, there are a lot of parts of this country that are not, you know, high cost of living. The fact that that would be an average, it's an amazing number. For those of you who don't live in the Bay Area or don't live in New York or some of the higher priced, you know, Seattle, some of the higher priced areas, amazing number. I wish we could talk more about this, sorry. How much more time do we have left, sir? Okay, good. All right, so perfect. So these are some of the job titles in the addendum. I just threw that in so you know what you'd be getting. So now I want to work into the next, you know, 10, 15 minutes. What does this mean for you? What do I think you ought to do with this? Well, I think the best bets right now in your area are in these industries. And by best bet, I mean opportunity to get jobs, opportunity to grow in them, opportunity to make a pretty good wage. I also would say opportunity for burnout, too. So there's a negative on this, too, where you're probably most likely to burn out in your job as well. But it's incredible opportunities from a career growth potential, I think, particularly in management. So what we did is we looked at our data and we looked at growth vectors and what's, you know, growth vectors, and we looked at a lot of what's coming ahead of us. We looked at pay numbers. We did this for skills, certifications, and for jobs. So these are some of the jobs, and we also ask people going forward, you know, what are you hiring into, and you know, how much you're going to pay these people, and how soon are you building this capability in your company? And so these are some of the titles. Again, titles could be misleading, but areas that we see as really high growth that are all, in our opinion, information and cybersecurity related. Any comments? Anybody want to say anything about this? You're a very quiet audience today. Anything surprise you on this list as well? Okay, so companies spent an estimated $137 billion on cybersecurity risk management last year. These are the most common AI-supported use cases, given that I think AI is something you very much want to be investing in and intensifying in terms of your own jobs. So we've got like eight that I want to point out to begin with that are special to me. It's these. These are the places that the use cases that companies are really, really hot on, and hot on people to help them do this stuff. And here are all the rest. It's a long list. It's a called list, as a matter of fact. Could be longer. This is actually as short as I could get it. This is what they're looking for. These are skills, capabilities, knowledge areas that they ask about. They're trying to increase the intensity of their talent. All right, so our three-year forecast in-demand security skill sets, again, we debate internally a lot about this in our company. There's a story, I guarantee you, that some analyst in my company is passionate about. If they're passionate enough and convince me, it goes on the list. If they can't convince me and another guy at our company, you know, who run research. They don't go on the list, but there's a story behind every one of these as to why we believe they're in demand. Sometimes in certain industries more than others. In-demand security certifications, this is a list that I put together because I'm very, very hard on in this area. I think certifications can be manipulated by vendors, and I think that they don't move always on market forces, but I'm willing to put these up as saying these are going up in value in the next 3 years, if they're still around, if they haven't been replaced. These are the job titles. I just wanted to put this up. This is kind of a funny slide. These are all the different jobs, cybersecurity job titles that we see, and this is a short list. I mean, it's crazy. Titles are not standard from company to company. This sort of tells you that that's true. People will call the same job 25 different things, but this is what we're dealing with in our business. We have to, you know, look behind these and be able to cluster these together. This is something that I wanted to show you. I mentioned before what CISOs are looking for. This is what they're looking for more than anything. They tell us we have plenty of tech skills. We know where to go to get tech skills. But this is what we're looking for. We need people who can communicate technology, deep things, to a non-technical audience and do it over and over again, who think business and can learn business speak. This is what they're looking for. They're desperate for this, for obvious reasons. They want people to understand the industry. They want people to be open-minded and think outside the box and all of that stuff. They want people to come to these conferences and speak. They say it all the time, you know, how do you get people in your organization to speak at conferences? I said, well, usually they want to, but it is frightening if you've never done it before. There's all kinds of ways that you can get this done, but you need to get out there as much as possible, develop those people skills. That's what we, again, hear from CSOs. They also talk about personality traits. This is why they're hiring defense attorneys into their businesses. They're hiring liberal artists. They're hiring people that did not come at their natural curiosity and their persistence and their always being suspicious. They didn't come at it from any other way, but they were born this way, in my opinion. No matter how, whatever their career arc it took, they're born this way. They're looking for people like this, personality traits. It's really important. They talk about this to us all the time. They said the technology part is easy. It's this stuff that I'm struggling with as a C-level executive. I just need more and more. I need a lot of help explaining all of this stuff. And I need it at every level, not just mine, but people reporting to me, people reporting to them, people reporting to them. And I liken it to a Swiss Army knife. This is not just cybersecurity professionals, but all tech professionals. This is the kind of qualities they're looking for in people in general. You know, again, none of this should come as a surprise to you. But this is worth money. What I'm telling you is this is worth money. You can negotiate salaries based on these soft skills if you can prove them. You have references that can prove them for you. Okay. So for recent college graduates, I think that they're looking for college graduates, but they're telling us they need a fundamental knowledge of computer architecture, cryptography, networking, data, secure code principles. Like, it's good that you have a degree, but they're looking for more. A very deep technical security training, secure system design. Good to have a degree, they want more. Needed for managers in the room a much wider approach to architecting cybersecurity. Again, we don't have time to talk about this much. I think you're going to be, what managers need to be doing is really get on this AI thing. You need to, don't hire anybody in your organization from this point on that doesn't have some of these abilities in AI. I mean, one or two or three. Do not hire anybody unless they have AI. I'm just telling you, it's coming at you that fast. You know, don't be caught. Unless they're just, they have some other quality that makes them, you know, godlike. You're going to be wanting to find people who are AI ready in your organization from this point on. Oh, by the way, I don't want to talk about this too much, but you need to be hiring a much more diverse, from a gender point of view, a culture point of view. You know, I have a daughter that speaks five languages. By 18 years old, she could speak five languages. Her life is different because of that. You know, it colored everything about what she knows about the world, that she can go places and talk to people in their language, she can read in their language. It's amazing how her education changed the moment she started learning languages. This is what we hear about cybersecurity groups. We just need a lot of diversity. There's so much going on. There's a communication aspect, because most of you are involved in global things. I would encourage you to look at some of this. And so I've given you some slides on non-traditional backgrounds of people to consider if you're managers. And the last one about more female cybersecurity professionals. We hear this all the time about just the way that females think differently than males in the cybersecurity world. I'm not up here to tell you that that's true or not, but I'm here to report that a lot of people that I talk to in organizations who are hiring feel this way. Okay, so I'm just, again, reporting it. Now, last slides, and then we're out of here. Apply what you've learned today. This is what I'd like you all to do in the next week. I'd like you to review this slide deck. Ask yourself three questions. Are you happy in your job right now? Hopefully you are. Third, where do you want to be in your career in the next 3 to 5 years from now? Do you know that? And if you do, can you get there from where you are right now? Just ask yourself those questions. Do this in the next week, okay? And if you don't have the answers, start thinking about them. You know, use this deck, look through the three-year forecast and the assumptions and job evolution and stuff, and see if that can kind of get your thinking going, particularly on where do I want to be. Next, in the first 3 months, I want you to, from your answers to those three questions, start formulating a plan. And I'm serious about what I'm talking about. The stakes are really high for you guys. You guys have an ability to just take a leap in your career, and I cannot say that to a lot of other tech professionals except the ones in this room. So decide on your destination, start your road mapping, draft a reasonable timeline, consider everything in it. Revisit this deck again. In 6 months, you should already be executing that plan, and then you need to recalibrate annually. Thank you. This is how to get a hold of me. You can get this also through the book. My headquarters is in Florida. I happen to be wherever I am. I don't really know where I'm from anymore. People tell me it's the New York metropolitan area. That's where I spend more time, so that's probably it. And then just our addendum will be salaries, and also something I couldn't talk about today, which is a framework, if you're particularly management, for how to think about putting a lot of these principles. It seems to work. It's just a framework. You don't need consultants or anything. It's just a framework for putting together some of these workforce transition behaviors in your company. And that's it. Thanks very much.